Blackstone Publishing presents John Woman by Walter Mosley. This book is read by Dion Graham. Who will believe my verse in time to come, if it were filled with your most high deserts? Though yet heaven knows it is but as a tomb which hides your life and shows not half your parts, if I could write the beauty of your eyes, and in fresh numbers number all your graces, the age to come would say, "This poet lies, such heavenly touches ne'er touched earthly faces." So should my papers, yellowed with their age, be scorned like old men of less truth than tongue, and your true rights be termed a poet's rage and stretched meter of an antique song. But were some child of yours alive that time, you should live twice, in it and in my rhyme. William Shakespeare, Sonnet 17. Before the Beginning. 1. Lucia Napoli's family name had been Tartarelli before her great-grandfather migrated from Naples to the Lower East Side. No one was certain how the name got changed. Lucia's Aunt Maria said it was a drunken Irish customs officer on Ellis Island who mistook their origins for their name. Lucia's great-uncle Christopher said his father, Alessio, introduced himself as Alessio from Napoli so often that the name stuck. Lucia didn't care where Napoli came from. It sounded better than Tartarelli. There were pastries and breasts and something flip in the sound. She liked the way it brought her lips together. "Like a kiss," she once told her girlfriends after her part-time shift as a filing clerk at Household Insurance Company. The neighborhood girls would go to smoke cigarettes and drink bitter Kinoto sodas at Uno, a little coffee shop on the Lower East Side patronized mostly by young students from NYU and old Italians from the mob. She met Jimmy at Uno on a Thursday afternoon. "When it was raining so hard, it was like God taking a piss on your head. All Jimmy had on was a t-shirt and some jeans, and you could see everything, and I mean everything, that boy had," she said to her 12-year-old son, Cornelius, when he told her that he liked Jenny Winters, the smartest girl in his class. "You know, the first time I seen Jimmy, I knew he was the man for me." She lifted a teacup from the coffee table and used a silver spoon to dump sugar in. 1, 2, 3 heaping scoops, then stirring. "His wet hair was hanging down on his forehead, and he looked at me like I was the only thing in the whole place. You know, you can't argue with a feeling like that." "So what did you do, Mama?" Cornelius asked, pushing his fingertips against his skinny thighs. They were sitting at the little table Lucia had set up in the bay window of the living room, looking down on Mott Street just below Grand.
"Do?"
she asked.
"I didn't do nothing, Cece. Just sat there looking at him, and he was taking me in, too. I waited where I was sitting with my girlfriends until he walked up to our table and asked me to go take a walk with him."
"In the rain?"
Cornelius asked, as he had many times before.
"Yeah,"
Lucia said, wistfully remembering the wet Jimmy Grimaldi at Uno.
"I told him that I didn't want to get wet, and he said that he'd try his best to keep me dry, but that he couldn't make no promises. My girlfriends told me not to go, but I did anyway. He took me down this little passageway at the side of the cafe and brought me into the alley back there."
"Then what did you do?"
Lucia's son asked. He was going to stay at her small apartment for the rest of the week, sleeping on the couch, because his father, Herman Jones, was in for a procedure at Marymount Hospital.
"The same thing you've been doing with that little smart girl in your class. The same thing all little boys and girls do when they can get away from spying eyes."
Cornelius hadn't done anything with Jenny Winters, but he knew not to say so to his mother. She didn't like it when he told her she was wrong. And if she got upset, she'd stop telling him about Jimmy Grimaldi and how she came to meet his father. Cornelius wanted to know what happened, and only his mother would be willing to tell him. His father was a good parent, but he didn't talk about what men and women did together. Even if Cornelius could get him to talk about sex, it would be very technical, like one of the 10,000 books Herman Jones was always reading.
Did you kiss him, Mama?
Oh, yes, I did. Your father has some very nice qualities, but I have never met a man who could kiss like Jimmy Grimaldi.
How come?
Cornelius asked.
He kissed me like he meant it,
Lucia Napoli Jones said. She was wearing a short black dress and black hose, sitting at the edge of her chair and gazing out the window. Cornelius thought that she was the most beautiful woman in the world. He felt bad that his parents didn't live together. His mother was still young and alive, while his father had gotten too old to keep up with her. But, Cece thought, maybe his mother could stay with them and still have her girlfriend's night out.
I love your father, Cece,
Lucia would tell her gangly brown son.
But I need to be on my own, to come and go when I want to. Herman only wants to stay around the movie house and read his old books.
I love you, Mama,
Cornelius would tell her when she complained about his father.
I love you too, baby,
was her standard reply. And I always will.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.